Welcome to Huntington, West Virginia, and the start of the New River Steam Train Excursion. Every fall, the National Railway Historical Society's Collis P. Huntington chapter organizes passenger train excursions through West Virginia's magnificent New River Gorge. Passengers board in Huntington, St. Albans, Charleston, and Montgomery for a thrilling and nostalgic trip through the New River Gorge and its fall colors to Hinton, West Virginia, and back. The round trip totals over 310 miles and lasts about 13 hours, including a two-hour layover in Hinton. All aboard now as we ready to depart Huntington. Recently, the Huntington chapter has been using number 765, an ex-nickel plate Berkshire, now owned by the Fort Wayne Railroad Historical Society in Indiana. More about the big 284 later. As we leave Huntington, passengers on the left pass the station. On the right, Huntington's yard is in view. Over 30 cars often make up the New River train to carry the 1,000-plus passengers on every trip. Passengers choosing premium service may visit several domed observation cars. Lounge cars. Diner cars, and others. There's even a concession car filled with souvenirs, snacks, and refreshments. Avid steam fans quickly find the vestibules between the cars the place for them. Prepared with protective goggles, they can literally satisfy their taste for coal cinders here. crossing the Guyandot River east of Huntington. The first stop for additional boarding is St. Albans. This unique view leaving St. Albans is from the last car on this trip, the Mardi Gras car. Passengers here pay for the extra view by feeling the total coupling slack from the forward cars during starts and stops. The trip continues to Charleston along the south side of the Kanawha River. While leaving, passengers get a full view of Charleston from the south side. Outside Charleston, the tracks run along Interstate 64, giving automobile travelers a trip back in time. Thank you. After passing under the West Virginia Turnpike, the trip continues through several small towns. Many area residents gather trackside to welcome the train, perhaps wishing all trains fired the coal which gave these towns their start. On the left are the London Locks and Dam, located west of Montgomery on the Kanawha River. Last boarding is at Montgomery, which is also the last stop to take on water before the long climb through the New River Gorge to Hinton. Since no water facilities exist along the route anymore, the Montgomery Fire Department tops off the tank. After Montgomery, the trip continues along the Kanawha River to where it meets the New River. We'll be right back. Hawk's Nest Dam, completed in 1933, traps water for diversion into a tunnel. The tunnel carries the water over 3 miles through a mountain to a hydroelectric plant near Gawley. Hundreds of the tunnel workers eventually lost their lives to silicosis, contracted from silica dust raised during digging. At the time, silica was thought harmless. Looking down 585 feet from the overlook at Hawk's Nest State Park, the train nears the bridge which takes track number one across to the north side of the New River. We'll stay on this side the rest of the trip through old railroad towns such as Sewell, Thurman, Thayer, Prince, and Meadow Creek. Whitewater rafters are often visible along this part of the river. Soon we pass under the New River Bridge, which carries US Route 19 across the gorge. The New River Bridge also plays host to an annual bridge jumping day, which generally coincides with one of the steam excursions. During the jumps, jumpers use a long rubber band-like line to save them from a wet and final ending. Every trip includes the proverbial photo run-by, where passengers detrain, the locomotive backs the train out of sight, and then roars back past for everyone's camera. This trip's photo run-by was near Sewell. To stop. Just before the town of Prince, the river takes a 5-mile meander. When the main line was replaced in 1930, Stretcher Neck Tunnel was built to shorten the route. Further on, in Meadow Creek, the engine, tender, and crew car are decoupled from the train for servicing.
Detector, detector. Miles was 374.4. No change. End of transmission.
Shandek train master ready to 765, over.
We're going to have to take water here.
Huh?
You know, we were not going to take water here to save time.
Yeah.
John Pace says you better take some. They're up there, they're all set up, boy, if you don't take any, I'm with you. My name will be
they got, food up there today, too.
Do they?
Yes, they do. So they told me they had it up there, right?
Well, we'll take water long enough to eat. You know, as soon as everybody's done eating, well, we'll just tell them that we got enough water.
Yeah.
Thank you.
say stop on the map.
Meanwhile, a pair of diesels pull the passengers on into Hempton. Here, passengers have a couple of hours to shop and relax before the return trip. In Meadow Creek, the engine is greased, and the tender is loaded with coal and water for the return trip.
'765 was built by the Lima Locomotive Works in August of 1944 and put in service immediately following. In just a few months, that particular order was completed, and then the 700s were finished in 1949 when 779 was built, which was the last steam engine built at the Lima Locomotive Works. 765 was one of 40 engines built by the Lima Locomotive Works in Lima, Ohio, for the New York, Chicago, and St. Louis Railroad. More popularly known as the Nickel Plate Road. It was mainly in service running from Fort Wayne to Chicago, although it did get on the Eastern Division into Buffalo occasionally. It was retired from service by the Nickel Plate in 1958 and donated to the city of Fort Wayne and put in Lawton Park which is on the west side of Fort Wayne and on static display. Then in 1972, a group of men from Fort Wayne, Indiana and Ohio, formed the Fort Wayne Railroad Historical Society and started negotiations to remove it from the park and do an extensive rebuild on it and put it back into excursion service. So in 72, it was removed from Lawton Park and taken to New Haven, Indiana, on a Ryan Road interchange, from where it was built, rebuilt outside without shop facilities, by hand and by back labor. It was rebuilt and put in excursion service in 1979. Well, it was all torn. It was all torn apart. The side rods were removed. The pins on the wheels for the side rods were turned and sanded. New bearings were made and put in. New rings put in the cylinders and the valve. Anything that looked worn or rusted was replaced. The side panel in the cab was replaced. New sheeting was put on the entire engine, and it was like new when it was done. It had to be custom cut, custom made by various machine shops around Fort Wayne in the immediate area, and then it was finally steamed up in 79 and run up and down the track at Ryan Road and then was put into excursion service. And excursions were run in 79, the summer of 79, and the summer of 1980, until it developed superheater trouble, and then it was pulled from service, and the superheaters were all pulled, and superheaters were donated to the Fort Wayne Society from 755 in Conneaut, Ohio, which were almost brand new when the engine was retired. So it gave 765 a good set of superheaters. They were all installed, and then in 81, and in the summer of 82, the excursion started, and it's been really great since 1982. A full summer of excursions all over the Middle West and the East, down in the New River Gorge in October, and it's really been put a lot of miles on the engine since the rebuild. Each winter, the engine is brought into our shop in New Haven, Indiana. We bring it inside, and then a report has been made all during the year of things that have gone wrong or could go wrong. So each winter we bring it in, and the natural maintenance schedule is to drop the side rods and take the bearings out, the old bearings, remelt them, make new tubs, and then remachine new side rod, rod brass. And then the front end is opened up. Any superheaters that have developed leaks is fixed. Any stay bolts in the firebox that have developed leaks will be new ones installed. Anything that that is even remotely going bad will be replaced. The engine is gone over completely, so that the maintenance on the road when we start again next summer will be minimized. Now, when the machine is on the road, about every 125 mile or at the midpoint of a excursion trip, it has to be lubricated. We take on cold water. The side rods have to be greased with a alumite gun that is under air pressure, and grease is shot into the bearings on the rods. The valve oil lubricator has to be filled. Soft grease is shot into the reversing gear. Everything is lubricated so that nothing dries and wears out while the engine is moving.
A Y track in Meadow Creek allows the engine to turn around. Then backs over 12 miles to Hinton and recouples for the trip back to Huntington.